So first of all, we are very glad to have here Professor Wenzel. I was very lucky to have my first contact with structural health monitoring in 2001 when his team made the first structural health monitoring, ambient vibration monitoring test in one of the piers of Otonosi Bridge in order to assess if there is an effect from the casting problems, voids and discontinuities inside the mass of the concrete in the Otonosi Bridge. So from then, in the recent 10 years, we had a good cooperation also with the Institute of Technical Seismology and Earthquake Engineering, Dr. Karakos Zedmekidis, and also Professor Papadimitriou from the University of Thessaly and the University of Aristotle University of Thessaloniki, with Professor Kakos and Sextos, who helped us a lot to establish, develop and apply a lot of applications in structural health monitoring, which I will try to show in my presentation with our progress and our results. So the base objective here is to find out methods and to apply methods that will give us a better insight on the actual, on the real performance and capacity of the bridges. We have a lot of bridges in Engatia Odos. These are the bridges that we have inspected in the recent years, also in the old road network of Greece. In Engatia we have some 1,000 bridges in the main axis and the vertical axis. Also we have a project inspection and a maintenance project in Balkans. So we have a big experience in inspecting mostly new established bridges, but also some old bridges in other old road network. So I first will go through fastly the conventional, the mostly commonly used methods of inspection. Before presenting structural health monitoring application, I will go through fast to the conventional testing and inspection for bridges. First of all, the fundamental, the visual inspection, which is a rule for all bridge operators and inspectors. The in-depth visual check of all the structural and functional elements of bridges is fundamental for their assessment and their condition rating. Every 2 to 5 years, depending on the funds, on the resources and on the personnel, we should monitor and inspect the basic bridge elements of the and piers, abutments, winkles, bearings, and so on. The basic bridge elements are inspected for detecting the following indication, manifestation of insufficiency, deterioration. Cracks, surface defects, spoiling, delamination, calcium leaching, discoloration, swelling, corrosion stains, corrosion with exposed parts, and so on. Critical information on bridges that are related indirectly indicating loss of structural integrity are the following: spur of piers, foundation or river bridges, rotation and settlements of piers, displacement distortion of the safety barriers, collecting drainage pipes, and in general of all the non-structural elements that follow the deflection sagging of the structural elements. So here we have some representative severe defects, damages in Greek bridges, most of them never inspected and maintained. But now I think we have a different attitude. We have a different way to manage bridges, also in Engatia and in other networks. We have routine inspection, and I think things change. But you can see that after 40 years, we have damage and disintegration of bearings. We have carbonation. We have corrosion, severe corrosion. Exposition of prestressing tendons and so on, that the basic question is how affect the remaining actual capacity and integrity of the bridges. So, based on the visual findings, first of all we have to give a score for the condition of the bridges. So, in worldwide, we have a lot of rating methods for the condition based on visual findings, but independently of the method, the basic thing is that there is a lot of subjectivity. According to a recent research of Federal Highway Administration, the subjectivity is big and affects the reliability of the condition rating results, and is as bigger as the scale of the rating is large. So 1-9 scale, which is the rule for US or the most US states, is produced more errors. So the basic is to separate in five basic condition rating classes. The first one is, of course, the new bridge. Bridge with no defect, with no problem, as you can see also in this picture. The second is small problems or defects that can affect the durability but do not affect the safety of the bridges. The condition rating three, of course, is problems that problems that affect not only the durability but also the safety of the bridge. And of course, condition rating one is bridge that it should be posted for loads or closed or immediately repaired and reinstated or replaced. So we did a lot of sufficiency rating and condition rating for bridges inspected. Also based on our results of all bridges that we have inspected, we produced an empirical deterioration curve, which we compared with the stochastic stochastic model we have in a bridge management system of Mateodos, and we can see that the result is not very bad. Also based on the favorable conditions, climate conditions of Greece, for bridges with do nothing for maintenance and inspection. After 40 years, we have the first major damages. So this is not a reason to continue to keep this policy, of course. After visual inspection, we have also non-catastrophic local concrete testing, as ultrasonic or Smith Hammer testing, which gives you also an insight, a better insight on the material strength and on the homogeneity of the material, but are really affected from the local damage and the surface damages of the concrete, which in most cases are not visible. For example, the lamination, which is not visible, can really affect the reliability of the ultrasonic measurements and gives you an erroneous result. Of course, this is the rule for the Smith Hammer and other tests. The ongoing corrosion of the steel is a big problem, and we have on time detect this. We have a lot of non-catastrophic testing, like half shell testing, where we can measure the voltage, the capacitance difference in the concrete between the steel, and if this voltage, this capacity difference is more than is more negative than minus 350 millivolt, then it is a 90% possibility that we have ongoing severe corrosion and the loss of the reinforcement section, which is a basic problem. Here we have some testing in Mateodos, which proved that the method, in combination with other data and information, can give you a good insight on the ongoing electrochemical mechanisms inside the concrete. So, from all this information, you need again a better insight in order to evaluate and assess the findings of the inspection, and of course, to see to look on the defects and on the damage, and to see if this affects the structural integrity of the bridge. So, structural head monitoring, it's an activity, it's a technology that supplementary structural assessment method. The main objective is by measuring the structural response of the bridge to identify its actual mechanical performance, static or dynamic, to detect any changes assigned to damage and thus to support critical decision making on the time, the type and the excess of metals. It's applied by installing instrument networks, sensors, on the surface of the concrete or embedding them during the construction, but which of course is not the case in our in Agratia. The target is to measure with special acquisition units from sensors the mechanical response. The measures can be either initial, if takes place before setting the bridge on service, or after the initial measure. Abbey vibration monitoring is extensively used in Agratia ODOS. We have permanent accelerometer arrays installed in some 12 bridges in combination with other types of sensors, in order to monitor the dynamic performance of the bridges, not only under traffic load and wind vibration, but also during seismic excitation, which we are lucky not to have yet in a peer-reviewed way. We have developed with the University of Thessaly a user-friendly model-based identification in order to analyze the ambient vibration data measured by our accelerometers and to identify the Encke frequencies, periods and modal damping ratios of the bridge, and with a modal model prediction to compare and to find the best fit in order to the measurable data to fit with the modal model predictions. So we use a lot of methods. The simpler is when the Encke frequencies are not close together. When in the same frequency window we have closed frequencies, then this is not so simple, and we have to apply a lot of methods in order to reliably identify the Encke frequencies. We have used this in a lot of applications, also for analyzing vibration data for the permanent, also from the temporary instrumented bridges of Egnatia Odos. And this is some cost data from the purchase and installation of the sensors. Sensor arrays in some bridges, in some ravine bridges in Egnatia. Types of sensors, force balance accelerometers, PC-based acquisition unit, inside the box rim, outside, on the pins, and so on. Here is a long-term monitoring with strain gauges, vibrating wires. The peaks here is the crossings of the heavy vehicles. And this is the temperature variation, and accordingly, the variation of the long-term variation of the strain. Bridge dynamic model updating. The problem is that we have identified the dynamic characteristics of the bridge. We have to calibrate our model in order the stiffness parameters or the mass parameters, usually the stiffness parameters, to be updated, such as the dynamic characteristics of the model to have the best fit with the dynamic characteristics identified by the experimental, the measured data. So I will go through some applications. Ambient vibration monitoring of all the derivative bridges. We try to calibrate and to test our method in all bridges. The problem there is that we miss the initial information. We don't have, this is the rule in Greece, we don't have the initial, the as-built drawings and documents in most of the cases. So the only comparison could be between the model based on a survey and the measured data. So here is a bridge selected for its extensive damage, Axios River Bridge, rating 2. We have a reduced safety factor, we have a fracture of pre-stressing tendons, we have an ongoing mechanism of corrosion, so we have for sure damages that affect the structural integrity and the safety of the bridge. So a part of other, you can see here some characteristic types of photos that show the extensive damage. So, apart from other site investigation, as catastrophic and non-catastrophic tests, laboratory tests, we also did some, and we found out that the real problem here is the small cover and the wet areas under the expansion joints from water leakage and under the drainage outlets. This is the main problem for the bridge. No chlorions, neither sulfates or other corrosive agents. The problem was the small cover, the permeability of the concrete, the exposition of the bars, and then after 30 years in service, the start of the ongoing corrosion, of excessive corrosion, and the fracture of pre-stressing tendon. So we did also an ambient vibration monitoring campaign. This is an array of sensors, accelerometers. We identified the fundamental mode shapes and Encke frequencies, and we compared with the model. The model based on a survey of the bridge. So here we can see that we have high value of modal damping for pre-stressed concrete. We have asymmetrical first bending mode, which also affects and reflects the damage. and we have higher frequencies, much lower than the model predicted. So, even if this method is not so sensitive to damage, this is a proof that this method, of course, with a more dense array of sensors, can reveal and analyze and find out what is the real effect of the damage to the structure and deck of the bridge. Things are not very bad here, because in the reality also, after the monitoring of the bridge, we found out that there is no crack, even with this severe loss of distressing tendons. We don't have cracks because under the real traffic loads, we don't have exceeding of the tensile stress of the concrete. So we have reduced safety factor, but for the moment, we are to the limit capable to function. Another bridge that is not so severely damaged is Trimonas River Bridge. It's an old bridge. It's maybe the only bridge very near to the sea. So we have chlorions, we have some spoilings, we have some loss of concrete and exposition of tendons. So there also we did a lot of tests, not catastrophic, catastrophic, and combined with abnormal vibration monitoring. We can see here some also characteristic types of defects. Also here, with the same way, we found out and we identified the fundamental modes of vibration based on the monitoring data. And here, the problem is that also we have higher frequencies, slightly lower than the model predicted. The problem here is not that we lose safety factor. The problem here is the concrete, which also revealed from the non-catastrophic and catastrophic test, we have lower qualities of concrete than we should have from the design. Another extensive abnormal vibration campaign was during construction in the Metsovo Bridge. Also, we have provided some characteristic abnormal vibration data to the service project. And we have them.
No, 2-3 minutes.
So I can go fast. You can see here some sensor arrays during construction. Here we managed to identify almost all the fundamental periods of the bridge as during construction as well in operation, with a very good fit in the frequency range. Ravin TAF 9 Ravin Bridge, the IRIS project. Also there we have a lot of results from abnormal vibration, and also we constructed a very analytical model in order to make a model updating with a very accurate model, fingerling model, and then through a static condensation we try to limit the number of the degrees of freedom and also the degrees of parameterization for the model update. The result was to take updating values for the stiffness of piers and deck, and then to also make analytically derive a vulnerability function based on monitored data, based on the actual stiffness of the bridge. Finally, it's very useful to see here that in some bridges that we have installed sensors from 2005, we are lucky to have the evolution of the dynamic characteristics from 2005 to 2015. We can say that we don't have really dramatic changes in the fundamental periods that bearings dominate the performance. We have, let's say, a slight increase of the frequency, but this is not something really valuable, because bearings under small stresses cannot be really updated or interpreted. But the fundamental bending modes, which are very important for the bridge operator, because this is the basic information for the integrity of the superstructure, there we have also not dramatic changes, and at the end, in the recent 3 or 4 years, we have a little increase of the stiffness of the precast beams. Finally, we have a Other goals of monitoring for a bridge that we made maintenance and strengthening, flexure and shear strengthening. So we made a combination of load test, static load test, with a survey monitoring and avid vibration monitoring. Here the interesting is that comparing two conditions, avid vibration data prior to the load test and avid vibration data during the load test, so two different load conditions. In the first condition, the bridge loaded from the permanent loads. In the second condition, the bridge loaded to the serviceability limit state. The tracks simulated the load 60-30 according to DIN 1072. So we have two different conditions. A very common argument against upper vibration monitoring is that we usually monitor bridges under low stresses, so the results are not reliable. So here we had the chance to compare both conditions, under permanent loads, under high loads. So the result was that the decrease of frequencies, the flexibility manifestation of the bridge, was not analogous. We had a bigger increase of the flexibility comparing to the model. It is basically an indication of cracking, but as we didn't observe cracks, we can say, and as of course at the end the frequency is still more stiff than of the model, the first information is that the bridge is good. The second is that combining with the with the visual findings, we didn't find any kind of cracks. So maybe micro cracking was present, and maybe the bridge trying to perform under serviceability limit state loads was a little more flexible and manifest its real performance. So this is the flexural strengthening of the bridge. So here is the flexural strengthening and the shear strengthening of the bridge with FRP strips for restating the capacity of the bridge under traffic loads. You can see some photos. So I don't have time to say a few words for stair monitoring.
No.
Thank you very much for the time. Yes, because it's the first time. Can say a few words.
It's okay.
So stair monitoring is not so, it's most commonly used comparing with the avid vibration monitoring. But it's really a mess because there are a lot of advantages and a lot of disadvantages. We found out that fiber optic strain sensors are more reliable, but because there is no aging, there is no effect of the time. Again, we have a problem of the temperature effect, which, as you know, it's a big problem because it's not only the effect of the temperature performance of the sensor, but it's the problem of performance of the bridge under temperature, which is not really predictable. So here we did our best to pre-strain the sensors in order to get a reliable compressive and not only tensile strain. We did our best, but at the end, the result was not very good according to tensile stresses. You can see here, here, we did it very well with the tensile stresses, and this is a good case with fiber black grating sensors, but we have a lot of problems with compressive strains because there was a debonding of the patched sensors under high loads and high stresses. This is not the case when we use pre-strained 2 meters optical sensors. Then we get a reliable also compressive strain, as you can see in this slide, which also is more expensive as a type of sensor, but is the only way to get a reliable compressive strain, and so to get the best information in the same section, in the same cross-section, to have simultaneous and reliable information both for the compressive fiber and the tensile fiber. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you
for a most interesting presentation. Now, as usual, we're running out of time, so I don't know if there is perhaps one or two urgent questions to some of the speakers, or otherwise we can retreat for a light lunch and you can ask your questions then. So I repeat, is someone who has a pressing question to ask to anyone of
the
speakers? Yes. Quickly, please.
Yes, for Mr. Sextos, I want to ask something. Because of the West Planter in Atia, we know that there are a lot of these panels and bridges, which is very important with high pierce. And if you examine your scenario for resilience-based design,